I thought I'll just prepare something to that's connected to something I'm reading right now. And I'm reading about contextual realism and perception from this guy, Jocelyn Benoit, who's a French guy who is trying to, well, to mix a bit like the main French tradition of philosophy, which is mostly postmodern and phenomenology, and to update it a bit with analytic philosophy and structuralism and semiotics. And he talks about perception, and I found his take on perception really interesting. And what I've done here in this photo is an attempt to, well, to make sense of what he's saying. And what he's saying, like his main thesis, is first that any conception, any representation, sorry, he's not talking about perception, it's more about representation. And he tries to absolve representation from this bad tradition it has in France and in continental philosophy, where representation is seen as a degrading of things or as a mediating perception that can lead to nihilism via the doubt of our representations actually representing something real and something outside of our mind. So the reputation that the concept of representation has is that if we think of things as representations, we might think of them as mere mental representations and therefore as something that doesn't really conform to reality. And his main theses are that any representation is something that relates and refers to something real every time. So there is no representation that doesn't refer to something real. And this is where he takes a lot from semiotics. And the second big thesis is that any representation and its status is contextually determined. And in order to make this clearer and to start a discussion, he bases his argumentation on a story of him visiting the Frank Lloyd Wright Museum, where the guide was telling them that a piece of furniture, a desk in the Wright House, was not the actual desk, like the real desk, but was a representation of that desk. So a remake of the desk, of the original. And his point is to say that precisely the context in which that representation is used determines its status. So first that the representation always refers to something real, to the original desk, but also that it is absurd to think of a concept of something original that then causes representations, because in the context of the museum, the representation is just as original as like the original desk, because it's just a placeholder, but it's a real placeholder. It has the same value of a real representation of a real object that fills in the meaning void of the old desk. So it has like a continuous story. But it's the story is more complicated than that. And well, yeah, guided by the picture and by the discussion, I hope to get to the details.
The last part reminds me a bit of I think it's the Forbidden Palace in Beijing that was completely destroyed during the Cultural Revolution. You can still go visit it. It's back. It's sort of not talked about, but they just rebuilt it.
Okay.
And it's still sort of the Forbidden Palace, but it's the same kind of structure, but it's not.
Okay. Yeah, see, that's a really good example. So is that the Forbidden Palace or not? Is that just a like a mere representation that has no value, has no meaning, has no real reference to it? Or what is the status of that new Forbidden Palace?
Like, isn't the heart of that question whether or not we have power to generate reality? Like, I had an argument with a friend the other day about phlogiston. I don't know if you've heard of phlogiston.
No.
It's like a now discredited force that was considered fundamental to how things work. There was like this phlogiston stuff that people try and measure, and there was a theory around it that how it would be used and how it had roles in various activities. It was an active component that is now no longer, it is being debunked. There is no such thing as phlogiston. But but it has a history, and it plays a role in the trajectory of scientific thought. So like it does exist, right? Representation had nothing to link it to other stuff, but we made something. We made phlogiston, and it has had a role.
Yeah, that's one point of the discussion that I wanted to get to, because one of the main arguments against realism that tries to reappropriate representation is that we also have epistemic mistakes, or we have illusions in which we might think that we are creating reality, and that might be a sign that we are dealing with mental representations and not with representations of reality. And this is where I liked what Benoit was saying, and he says that concept, in his opinion, would still be a representation, but a misrepresentation. So it would be like a mistaken representation done with no malintent, with no intent of deceiving, but it's still something that relates to certain real states of affairs as an attempt to explain those states of affairs, which are real. So it still refers to reality. It's not a construction of reality, but it is a misrepresentation of reality. And this is what I was trying to do with the last picture, for example, like the last sketch I did there of the pill, which is not a representation of the pill. I mean, you wouldn't think of a pill if you look at that, but it can be considered as a misrepresentation of the pill. Or why not a deeper representation of the pill if we think of artistic movements like Cubism or movements that do not try to depict something as realistic as possible, but precisely to deconstruct that representation. But it still remains in reference to a real thing. And here is where the contextual part of Benoit comes in, but it never refers to that real thing in its entirety. It's always a contextual representation.
Like, that's a little bit like Harman saying something is withdrawn, right? The real object is withdrawn, but the reason it's withdrawn is that you always access it through context, but through a limiting function.
Yes, but for contextual realism, there is no distinction between like the real core of the object and its several aspects. Like the representation of the pill from a contextual point of view is a real representation of the object. It's not something that hides the object, or is not something that remains on the surface of the object, but it is nevertheless restricted by the context in which it's used.
It seems like there is a sort of presupposition that the original would be more real. So my question would be, how can you place the status of a representation itself, like being less or more real? Because one question is to say if it refers to something real, and the other is of if the status of the original and then the copy, because if you that is the point. So this whole story about representation goes back to the origins of philosophy, where there's like this hierarchy between the original and all the copies. And also in this case of the pill, you have like this pill and the representation. And when you use the very word representation, then there's a sort of a vague or very clear assertion that one is more original. And in saying that the one is more original, it's kind of saying it's real. And that's the measure of the truth or falsehood of the representation. So again, you have a hierarchy.
Yes, that's an important question. And so for Benoit, the way he tries to get rid of this dilemma is to say that the representation is not, so that the real thing that the representation refers to is not an original. So he tries to say that the concept of original things is unsustainable, and that both the represented object and the representation are, both of them are originals. So the representation is an original representation of another original. So they both have the status of realities. It's just that one reality refers to another, but not as its copy, but a reality that stands in relation to another reality. And the example he gives, using going back to this museum of Wright's house, is that he takes this like absurd example in which if we were to talk about the original desk, we would have to take into consideration that that original desk could only be considered original if it would be shown in the Wright's house during their lifetime. So during their, it's like original use. And only during that original use could it be shown as an original. But then again, in order to show it, you would have to have either actors or the actual Wrights play out their lives in front of like spectators. And then the Wrights themselves would be mere representations of what would be considered of an original of themselves. And then any original would presuppose this infinite amount of relations and information and history that led up to that moment in time in which the disc is seen by somebody or is experienced by somebody. So for him, that's where the concept of original kind of implodes, in the sense that there is no one authentic object that then gets reproduced in representations, which would be like the dilemma that you're referring to, but that all representations and objects are mere references to one another, but all of them have the status of original reality. So original in this sense was just used as like a stepping stone to show how the normal use of representation in philosophy is not sustainable.
Like, I guess it's the re-representation, if a representation is a copy, then you sort of have to have an original, I think. Because in principle, if it's a copy, it should degrade every time it's copied, right? So almost the definition of copy. So each representation of a representation would in some way be a degradation of the original, which means that at some point you sort of have to run out of reality, right? If they were copies, so that if they were copies, we'd probably run out of reality.
Mm-hmm,
so
mm-hmm.
There can't be originals and copies.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, everything would be quite corrupted, I think.
Okay, I see.
But isn't that just like going around a problem? Like, okay, let's not just use the word copy, but at the end you have a measure and something which is measured by it, which would be like the reference of this desk of the painting is this original thing. I mean, I don't care about the word, but of course there's an asymmetry between both implied in a painting, implied in the like the forbidden temple, which was constructed with the parameter of the original one. So it's not about talking about copy or not, but that there's some sort of paradigm or reference or measure from which you talk about something which is represented, painted, and so on, reconstructed.
Yeah, I understand what you're saying, but at the same time, so representation is precisely that reference to a real object. And representation is used here in the human context. And it is used as ways of relating to like real things. He just uses like normal day objects in order to get to a meaning of representation other than that constructed within a conceptual system of various philosophers. So he is highly influenced by what is called apparently the ordinary turn, which means to look at how words are used in everyday usage and start from there to develop the meaning and not from a separate conceptual system that is laden with philosophical meaning as well. So that's also like his methodology, to start from the use of representation in the museum context. So something that is unreflectively used as representation. And his point is, how do we normally use representation without reflecting, without inserting there any ontological claims or whatever? We normally assume that the representation is something real being said or being experienced or being seen about a real object. It's not something constructed with no reference to any real object. Of course, that representation is not the object. That is why the realism is also called contextual realism. It is a perspective, or it is one aspect of an object that it refers to. But this is placed in the context of cognition. And it makes a huge difference to say this is an aspect of a real object, and that real object is neither one authentic or primordial original that then just gets copied, but is not in any way present in the representation, or to the most extreme case in which you say that representation is an empty concept, so an empty reference, like a self-reference, in which your mental representations just stand in relation to your cognitive apparatus. So it's not just about the words, it's also about the way of relating. And from that, you get the ontological, maybe, claim that we do have relations to real things, and our relations to those real things are not second, like degraded copies or less important aspects of things than the real qualities they have. And this refers also to primary and secondary quality. Like, it touches on this this problem of epistemology and metaphysics that says, okay, there are real things outside of our heads, outside of our bodies, outside of our imagination, but all we see about them are secondary quality. So qualities that that do not have to do anything with like the original essential reality of that object, which would be the dichotomy and harmony between sensual and real quality, which is pretty dogmatic if you think about it. And contextual realism says tries to get away or escape this dichotomy between secondary and primary qualities by stating that the reference to an object are the real quality. But those real qualities can also be misrepresented. And because of that possibility of misrepresentation, you can also end up with concepts like the one Scott was talking about that was trying to represent something that was never there. But it's still related to things outside of like the representation. So it's still related to a state of affairs as real as the representation. Just in a... Yeah, sorry.
Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt, sorry. That's sort of the complicated part, though. Like, we can represent things that may or may not exist. And we can represent things that do. Like, we can, like in this case with the image you have, you clearly represented something, an element of something that exists, right? There's definitely a pill there, or a candy. And its physical properties are being represented. But with something like phlogiston, whatever it's called, it sort of existed. In like the, it was... Their theory was not parsimonious, but they were trying to explain stuff that was going on. And there's sort of the difference between representing the pill and re-representing something like value or gravity, because they may or may not actually, like we don't catch eyes upon them. We don't know they're actually there. They're the only grounding we have is inference.
That is the tricky part. But so here is also one other side of the story, which shows how like the difficulties this contextual realism has, especially when it draws from like language theory and structuralism or semiotics or whatever. They have to rely on the difference between veridical and non-veridical representations. And veridical representations are representations in which the intent is to represent something that exists. Non-veridical representations can be fantasizing about something, contemplating, can be religious, contents can be lies, for example. They can be, I don't know, beliefs also. So they do not have this like verification or validation property to them, but veridical representations do. And his point, what he's trying to say is that representation, if we look at like the day-to-day usage of the word, should only be restricted to veridical representations. Everything that is non-veridical, so made with the intent of not representing or referencing to something existent, should be classified as something else, not representation. And representation should only be used in cognitive sense, in which you have the intent of knowing something. You don't have the intent of unknowing something or mistakenly knowing something. But nevertheless, even within veridical representations, there is still the possibility of misrepresenting. But that doesn't make them non-real representations. And this is what I find problematic about what Benoit says. The distinction between veridical and non-veridical representations can be really arbitrary, especially if it relies on the intent of the one representing.
Yeah, it doesn't depend on veracity, it seems.
Mm-hmm.
Which is complicated.
That goes back to the Cartesian typical problem. I mean, like Scott said, when it were about just veracity, what if there's a demon, which is, you cannot place the veridical representation or base it in the fact of wanting it to be true or the intention of your representation. You understand what I mean?
I mean, the
standard which he's using to divide veridical and non-veridical, it's very, how do you say in English, caprichoso, how do you say, Jaime must know?
Picky
somehow.
Yeah, I understand what you're saying, and that's why I also think it's complicated. So his criteria for veridical is that it refers to something existent, and that's all. It doesn't have to be true. So it doesn't have to be like a correct representation. But if I represent the pill in, I don't know, as like a square, I'm still referring to that pill. And I'm still misrepresenting a real existent. What you were saying about Descartes and the demon who might deceive us, that is a tricky point, I think, for this theory. I would say that, I don't know, Benoit would argue against that if you have deceived representations, you still have like representations relating to the way somebody with malintent has conveyed you information. But also in this scenario, and this is an argument often used in phenomenology, for example, against Descartes, is that reality for Descartes is never achieved or never grounded purely and solely in thinking, but in thinking in relation to something. It is either in relation to the world in a first stage, then in relation to dreams, in relation to mathematical objects, in relation to a demon that is presupposed as existent, or in relation to thinking itself, in which thinking is separated from the proposition of existence. But then Descartes also sees that grounding in thinking alone is not sustainable, and that's why he brings in the idea of God in order to maintain the plausibility of existence through thinking. So in each one of these steps, this is the argument some phenomenologists use, in which each one of these doubting steps, there is always something else than thinking involved. Otherwise, the argument doesn't work. So if we take this to the extreme, even in trying to represent non-existence, you still refer to existence.
Is that akin to saying, like, you can't think without experiencing your thought?
So without taking into account the fact that Descartes always relates either to something exterior to himself that he has to doubt, or to something that deceives him, which is different than his mind, or that he relates to God as this benevolent God that ensures him that what he sees is real or what he thinks it is real. Also in that, like, really tiny sentence, "I think, therefore I am," it's some interpret it as, "I think my thoughts, therefore I think that I am." So even in that, like, cogito ergo sum, there is the thinking of something involved. So there is a referencing involved. It's not, like you were saying, it's not like pure thought, but instead what he's saying, and this is maybe a bit exaggerated, but in each thought that I'm thinking, thinking is presupposed as existent. So there is this distinction between pure thinking, thought, and the existence of the one doing the thinking.
Yeah, I think that fits with a lot of neuroscience also, in that it's like spontaneous thought or thinking is often referred to as something like an unconstrained memory process, or the experience of some model of the world having a mismatch. I'm never quite sure where the definition of thought between things diverges a little bit, but sort of spontaneous mental imagery or narrative, or any kind of internal exposition, some part of that is likely to be a memory process that's sort of going on in the background. Like when you walk to work and you think about what you had for breakfast, or shudder, like those sort of things are sort of just unconstrained memory process talking along in the background. And then we experience parts of whatever encoding process.
Yeah, I was just trying to say that. So that doesn't really qualify as spontaneous thinking for like this context of Descartes and idealists. Spontaneous thinking is more precisely the capability of thinking not as reacting. So spontaneity in thinking in like modern philosophy was regarded as the independence of thinking, reason, or whatever regarding nature. So the fact that sensibility, like the affective part, is reactive. It just reacts and perceives and records stimuli, and then thinking processes that. So it does the work, it's active. That's spontaneity in the philosophical part. But
it's generative.
It doesn't have to be generative. It generates order. So it takes like an unordered material and generates judgments and predicates about that material in order to structure it. But it doesn't generate realities, unless we're dealing with practical aspects. Acts, like practical acts or moral acts, those are generative in the sense of producing realities. When you are acting, like when you're doing, I don't know, a good deed, you are generating a new reality.
But let's say, like, it's, say, confidence. You become explicitly more confident in something having considered it or thought about it. Like the arrival of a bus. Mm-hmm. So your central object is sort of the bus timetable and the bus shelter and all the stuff around you, and you're waiting for the bus to come, and it's not, it's past the time it should arrive.
Mm-hmm.
And then, like, one simple thought is, like, do I wait? And that requires then sort of a confidence statement about the bus. And that would that be a thought in this context? Are you considering how likely it is that you missed it? When did you arrive? What are the possibilities for delay?
No, yes, it is a thought. And this is where, because you were saying you're not really sure how thoughts and in philosophy and psychology actually relate. And So I'm not referring to philosophy in general. I'm mostly referring here to this context of philosophy, modern philosophy, starting with Descartes. And there you have like two levels of thinking. You have psychological thinking, which is regarded as mental acts, precisely like the one you were describing, like isolated mental acts that I am thinking randomly while crossing the street. And then you have the mental acts which are grounded in a unitary kind of thinking, which relates more to the structures of how thought is possible. And that is a non-psychological way of thinking about thoughts. So it's a more foundational, it relates to like intersubjective structures of meaning, let's say, of how meaning is generated.
Ah, I see.
But it doesn't have to do with individual mental acts. So individual mental acts are considered as empirical, as part of the empirical day-to-day life, like how you interact in this instant with a given object. So like an individual mental processing. And then the more fundamental thinking would be the one that describes the forms of thinking that make that individual mental processing possible.
Like it's core units almost, like the types and variable forms of thought that would lead to that kind of content. Like psychological thought could be described almost as sort of content.
Yeah. I think that would be a good description. Yeah.
That's interesting. And I had made that split, I think, explicitly before.
Mm-hmm.
So it's interesting. I've encountered this new concept called, which relates, I think, to this. Stop me if it doesn't. It's this thing called a 3D mind model. And this is a new theory that's trying to posit, trying to make the argument that there's three dimensions upon which we represent the mental states of others.
Sorry, can you repeat that?
What's it's called the 3D mind model. It's by this interesting lab, the Tamir lab. And they're trying to create like a three-dimensional space on which we can, on which we represent the minds of others. And it's sort of it's complex to think how you would determine if this is actually a base in reality or not, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because the mental states of others are not necessarily something we can clearly ground.
Mm-hmm.
So there's this whole series of attempts to show that like mental states tend to move in a certain order. So that someone that's happy is more likely to be grateful than they are to be disgusted in the next subsequent moment. So people seem to move their emotions along these axes, right?
Mm-hmm.
Being rational, these people who are being rational in one moment are more likely to be rational in the next than irrational. And they're more likely to be rational than emotional, or more likely to be happy and sort of aroused and energetic than not, or to have social impact or not. But there's many steps where they go through to show that this is real. So for example, showing people who transition in this manner, sort of through this space, then showing that our brains also represent it, in that you can see computations of that axes very clearly in neural studies, if you do the right math. And then if you look at texts, so like ancient Chinese texts or the Bible or Twitter or books or whatever, like Google text corpus you look at, you also see there's a relationship in the sort of use distance between these terms.
Mm-hmm.
And even if you get people to rate it themselves, so like you have all these terms in the list, people, if they rate them on their proximity, they also fall in these three dimensions. So they're sort of grabbing at different parts of reality to try and show that these axes make sense, whether it's Twitter data, brain activity, people choosing it themselves, the actual states that are being represented, all these transition probabilities sort of match across all these spaces and predict each other.
And why do you think this would not qualify as representation?
I think it's interesting in that the lengths they had to go to make clear that they're representing something that's potentially real. Because it's a representation of mental states, which are, I guess, a principle of representation.
I see. Like, they're not trying to represent the actual content, right? But they're trying to represent the process of how that content is created.
Yeah.
So they're not representing the actual representation that the person has. They're just representing how that person in certain scenarios processes the scenarios that it experiences.
and how we would represent others' mental states.
Okay, so they are trying to like represent the content that others represent.
Yeah, like if we had to decide where, like we had to make an attribution to this person, it would be somewhere in this axis space, mm-hmm. right? It'd be like here or here or here,
mm-hmm.
and that we use that information to define people in the world around us.
Mm-hmm. I see. Okay, this reminds me of something that, so one of the only things that I really enjoyed from like semiotics was how metaphors are formed. And metaphors are, in semiotics, a representation of an already represented object. So it's gaining this symbolical level of something, which is still saying something about something, but it is like a double representation. So
yeah, it's like
maybe they have a metaphor of the content then.
Exactly. Yeah, I think that's, although they're trying to instantiate it computationally, so it's like a computationally grounded metaphor.
Mm.
But like when I think of metaphors, I think of them slightly different. So like in the US, they call cash machines ATMs. And in Ireland, we call them a hole in the wall. Like, one is a representation and one is a metaphor. Or they're both representations, but one is also a metaphor. Like, I think an ATM is not a metaphor, right? It's a flattening, an unfortunate flattening of something we talk about regularly. Whereas hole in the wall is sort of a pleasing new reality created about something trivial. One trivializes further and one sort of makes amusing.
Well, this says something interesting about representation itself, that representation is also a cultural thing.
So it's fairly easy to see how representations are either culturally or contextually defined, which doesn't make them less real or less veridical, but does say that they are situational. And in that sense, we can also talk of truth as situational. So in the sense that we do not want to negate the possibility of having true statements, or at least veridical statements, but we do want to introduce this important detail that those statements are also situational. They refer to a certain state of affair and do not exhaust the entirety of states of affairs, nor the entire reality of the state of affairs that they relate to. But at the same time, we also have like gradients in the veridicity of various statements, because it is true to say in Ireland a hole in the wall, but it's not true to say, I don't know, that the same thing in China, but it is true to say that the earth is round and it spins around the sun and whatever. And it is both true in Ireland and in China and wherever you go, except for people who have misrepresentations like conspiracy. But then again, and this is what is relevant to TTT and I think has led to this, how do we manage that, those gradients in veridicity of different statements? What makes the law of gravity more veridical? And by more veridical, I mean in more situations. So across a really vast number of situations, what makes it more situational broad than a hole in the wall, for example?
I guess it's worth pointing out that even the example of the Earth orbiting the sun is partly situational, right? Like our view of the solar system is there's a thing here and then the Earth's going around it, right? That's not really true. The Earth's going, or the sun's going somewhere in this direction, and the Earth is sort of going like this around it, right? Like they're
exactly
even the,
yeah,
or the heliocentrism. It's true up to a point, but because you're taking a solar system perspective, like there's of course the Earth is still orbiting the sun and such, but it's not. They're both sort of going their own way. One is still following the other somewhat, but it's not necessarily just orbiting the way we see a solar system.
Yeah, exactly. But still, it's more like you can state that and have it situationally true in more situations than stating a hole in the wall is an ATM machine.
Yeah, yeah.
So what makes possible that difference? So what I'm trying to get at is that in order to have like a true statement that is valid for a vast situation or a vast situational field, flattening seems to be involved in the sense that you have this. So despite the fact that the situational field is vast, the one thing that is true across that situational field is something that doesn't relate to the intimate existence of all things in that situational field. So the law of gravity is true about me and you, and also the planets revolving around the sun, and also about the sun and everything that is in the solar system and beyond. But it doesn't say nothing more than that. It doesn't say anything about the way I interact with my family, the way what I study, what I do. So it's something that says something about a lot of things, but not much about those things.
I guess value is kind of the clearest example.
Yeah.
So like economics tries to impose this single metric of value on everything.
Exactly.
When we assume that the brain represents something like value,
mm-hmm.
but we're not sure because we can't distinguish it from others.
Mm-hmm.
But there's this very powerful concept of value that's super important in our society, possibly in the way we understand the brain, but it's a useful but not necessarily critical.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. It says something very specific and powerful about lots of things, but not much about each of those things in there.
Exactly. Yeah. So that's what in TTT would be defined as breadth of relationality. So how far it spans across situations, and the depth of relationality would be how much it says about the things in those situations. And those are, each of them are interconnected, and you can have both broad and deep things, like a pandemic, for example, where it touches so many people. And when you say pandemic, you somehow, being in the midst of it, you empathize with, like you identify in that one word a lot of suffering, a lot of chaos, a lot of confusion, a lot of economical problems, and so on and so forth, which are valid for pretty much everybody on this planet. So that's a thing that's both broad and deep, let's say. And then you have the economical algorithms that try values that try to reduce everything to one exact metric, and that can say a lot about, that can say something about a lot of things, but they are not necessarily deep. So they don't go into the intimate relations, into the more individual or local set of relational richness.
If you had to sort of, like, breadth, like pandemic seems like it has very high breadth. But if you just use the word to refer to this spread of an illness, it's very broad but shallow. But if you go into like the phenomenology of being on a ventilator or of losing a loved one or of losing your job as a result, that's sort of the depth, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that makes sense.
Well, there's a very similar difference between what is called thick and thin ethical concepts. The thin concepts like good or bad, they have just an evaluative description. Whereas saying generous, saying courageous has an evaluative description, but besides it has a non-evaluative, meaning a content, meaning something specifically.
Okay, I understand. And I think that is compatible with depth and breadth in this context. And I think it's really, I mean, for me, it's a valuable insight of how relationality, especially in the TTT format, can be applied to ethics and how it can map our relation to morality and ethics. The fact that we often float around these like superficial evaluative concepts, but the difficulties arise when you go into the depth of them, when they touch on either an individual values, an individual acts in specific contexts, in specific conditions.
So breadth and depth, just to be clear, they're not contradictory.
No. They're part of the same relational thing, or they pertain to all things in on a descriptive level, of course. And they are often, no, they are always intertwined. But like what we notice now is that something that is really generalizable is often shallow, let's say, but is broader. But in the same sense, any breadth also has a depth, and any depth also has a breadth, and they influence each other and determine in a manner, they determine a diagonal dimension. So the diagonal dimension is the one that binds the two together. It's the description of how depth and breadth come together, much like in a two-dimension graph, for example, where you have two axes and you can draw the curve of the descriptive curve of a certain phenomenon within those axes.
So if I wanted to be like the person who had the most optimal knowledge for the least amount of sort of space of knowledge, I want all my representations to be broad and deep.
Yeah.
Those are the good ones.
Well, I wouldn't say something is good or bad. I think the term shallow is a bit deceiving here, because it's all contextual also. I mean, from a cognitive point of view, it's really okay to have really shallow but really broad representations, like the law of gravity or the speed of light or, I don't know, the theory of relativity. And that works towards, I don't know, predictive models, that works towards scientific truths. And even though shallow, they are not bad. But I think it is essential to take into consideration that any shallow truth can also be deepened. So you can always take that really generalizable statement and apply it within a local system, and also take into account further variables and just keep on digging. So this mapping of like breadth and depth and the various variations that it can have of flattening, that can serve as an instrument, as a tool for an ontological topology of things. For example, you can look at how things which are all equally real navigate certain situations and accept certain statements about themselves based on this like mapping process. So you can say, I don't know, Kant's philosophy is veridical in the context of cognition and is generalizable across Newtonian systems. But it lacks the depth of addressing non-human things or non-human processes, and that lack, so that lack of depth, can also motivate you to also broaden and deepen Kant's philosophy and look for non-human relations or the possibility of non-human processes.